allows you to make create custom commands. If in case the assistant is integrated either in your platform or your hardware. So for an example, if you're launching a new dishwasher and you want it to be smart, you feed in a command such as start hypercycle, and even though it's not really a industry standard, it would still hold true for your product. And lastly, one of the examples is MG Hector, which launched Internet Insight. So its USP is voice, and it is India's first internet car that is connected to almost 50 plus features. You can get things done with the voice assistant, such as finding your cab, tracking your vehicle, geo-navigation, or even knowing more about your car just by using the voice assistant.
In order to find what does these conversational interfaces mean for e-commerce, we conducted multiple kinds of research. The objectives were to understand the users in depth, what are their behaviors, how these interfaces are used by those people, and are these interfaces useful for their pain points. So we started with a lot of reading about the industry standards and what all is out there in voice and chatbots. We started reading about conversational interfaces, how they are being used, perceived, tested, and designed globally. Based on the data we had, we also conducted expert reviews internally. We wanted to understand we basically wanted to evaluate the existing elements which are from both chatbots and voice. We actually encourage a lot of collaboration in all research projects, and therefore in this panel we had a bunch of researchers as well as designers. We did a deep dive with foundational research and wanted to understand how our users are. We visited multiple cities and visited their homes. We immersed ourselves in the environment to actually understand what are their needs and their jugaads. It's very important to understand who the users are and where they come from, because it might be very different from ours.
So from these studies, we understood a range of insights, but also contrasts. So do any of you remember how you first started using the internet? Okay. So I remember for me, it was back in almost 10th, 11th standard, and my dad had this Windows XP desktop, which was pretty big. And while connecting to the internet, it took a lot of time, and there was this peculiar buzzing sound, which I still remember what it made. So for many of us, our journey started something like this. We started with the email and the browser, and this was specifically on the desktop. Then we moved ahead to using the smartphone. We used the Facebooks, the Flipkarts, the Olas of the world. This was both on smartphone and desktop or laptop. He has a Play Store account from he either downloads the apps or he gets those apps via share it from his friends' phones. Then he starts using Facebook and WhatsApp extensively. These form the pillars of trust for them online. Then they move ahead to you having free content. This was accessed from YouTube or Hotstar. The main thing to remember over here is the smartphone. It has been the constant throughout the journey. Also, it's not the smartphone that we have which is at the mint condition. These smartphones can be hand-me-downs or just lower RAM, lower storage ones, which you get below 10,000 rupees. And then we'll see how their journey go ahead. So what do we understand from this? We understand that we are not a user. It is very important to understand who our users are. It is very important to ask questions such as, who is my target user? How is my application relevant to this target user? Are there various segments in this target user? And are there different kind of services that are used or that are provided to the users that we have? So on the same thread, thousands of Indians come online for the first time every month. And these Indians may not be as proficient in English as we are, right? So a lot of companies have been pulling out vernacular capabilities on their platforms where they are literally translating their English app into the native language app. I would ask a question. Imagine you have opened an app which is translated in your own native language, and you come across a word that is an exact translation of the word notification. How many of you would understand that? It is very because our users don't really use such words every day in their life, and these are quite difficult words if you think about it, even in our native language. It is very important then to use translation versus transliteration wisely. How many of you remember a last time when you made a typing mistake? So a lot of users aren't really aware of the autocorrect feature that Google has. So they're bound to make spelling mistakes while typing or searching on e-commerce websites. And then this results in throwing a lot of either irrelevant results or no results at all. So what happens is, because this takes a lot of time, they spend a lot of time in finding products that they want and shortlisting, and it sort of overburdens our user and affects their overall cognitive load. We also use a lot of jargons on our apps, such as cart, wishlist, business days, which our users don't really come across in their day-to-day offline shopping if we think about it. Also, there is a tendency of our users to not really make mistakes. And if they make mistakes, then there is a massive self-blame that they do upon themselves, that, oh, I did this wrong, this must be something wrong with me, or I'll just break my phone. So it is very important to have our app that is extremely comprehensible for our users and not use such words which aren't part of their day-to-day life.
With this, we started rethinking about how these e-commerce complexities can be solved through conversational interfaces. We asked ourselves a lot of questions. How might we introduce conversational interfaces? How might we impart clarity via conversational interfaces? How might we enable users to carry out their tasks effortlessly? And lot of other bunch of questions. So let's try to understand what is conversation. Conversation is more than the literal exchange of information. By this, I mean conversation has to map with all the fundamentals we define to solve our e-commerce complexities. Also, conversation has some principles to follow. I'll cover some of the major three here. Before we go on to the principle, let's try to observe this conversation with Siri. Who is it, Siri?
Here's what I found.
What is the name of his latest song? Never mind, Siri.
I'm okay if you're okay.
Now, let's try to observe another conversation with Siri. Who is Shah Rukh Khan?
Here's what I found.
Where was he born?
Shah Rukh Khan was born in Purna.
What is the name of his wife?
Shah Rukh Khan is married to Gauri Khan.
Thanks, Siri.
My pleasure, as always.
So, what did you observe in these two conversations? Context is the key component in a conversation. Context helps people associate new information with familiar concepts, and hence it eases cognitive load. Also, in conversational interfaces, remembering the past is also a key element. Remembering what happened in the previous interactions or previous conversations. For example, in e-commerce, it could be what you ordered yesterday. Also, remembering earlier within the same conversation like Siri example of Shah Rukh Khan. It actually captured he, his, and everything. You don't have to say every time Shah Rukh Khan. It maintained that context. After context, the next basic principle is confirmation. Confirmation in a conversation depends on the confidence score. It tells you what kind of confirmation is needed. Explicit, where the system forces the user to confirm an information. For example, in e-commerce it would be, would you want to pay for this order? Or implicit, where the system tells the user what is understood by it. For example, it could be, I have added this item to your cart. Humans also tend to make errors and when they interact with each other. And they often recover from those errors with further conversation and with further gestures. So how can we do error recovery in conversation interfaces? First is to educate the user about what is happening in the conversation interface. Second, you need to tell the user where to provide a clear way where they have to move on. Third is to educate the user about the next step. Being empathetic with the situation and let the user move forward in the task. If you do a good job, error conditions won't derail your users and you will get them back on track and have them successfully complete the task. If you handle it poorly, not only they will be able to complete the task, but they will never come back.
So that was all about how do you design the conversations. But how do you present them to the user? How do you make the user more comfortable once he or she comes onto our interface? Do you remember any first date you have been to? How do you imagine your first date would go? The information should be efficient enough so that we portray what all our interface can do, but not as much that we overburden our user with it. For e-commerce, it could go something like this. I can help you with 1, shopping, 2, payments, 3, something else. Imagine your onboarding is perfect. Your user has come to your interface after a few days, and your interface says nothing. It's just waiting for the user. It is the interface's job to take initiative. Identify the moments where the user comes in and says hi and use those moments to engage in a newer conversation or to just give guidance. From an e-commerce context, we could go something like this. How can you help you today? I can help you with shopping, tracking your order, payments, or help. This is one of the most important things in interface. When a user comes and chats to our interface either by chat or by voice, the user implication is quite high because it comes across to him as something very real. Hence, it is very important to define what would be the voice of our interface. It is very important to define things such as, would our language be formal? Would it be casual? How would it be the tone? Would it be over-enthusiastic? Or would it be just casual? And then we add that to the personality of our interface, where we take characteristics that are more human-like and then associate that to our interface. We define the gender. How will that gender be portrayed to our user? We define if our interface has humor, and so on.
We today discussed about the e-conversational interfaces. We tried to understand the e-commerce complexities and also tried to understand what is conversation. To bring all this together, we are following 3 mantras of our own. First is assistive. It could have assistive capabilities of system interactions. By this, I mean it should guide the user in every dimension of e-commerce space. Emotive. It could have all the emotional aspects of user-system interactions. Emotion emerges as a result of system, of the interaction with system or product. Immersive. This could be based on human perception and attention, which brings actually the enchantment to the users. So our mantras are assist, emote, immerse. Thank you.
It was really nice to have you guys here.